Thank you. So have fun in the break. No, of course, I'm just joking because this is like one of the most horrible benchmarks that I could ever imagine. And sometimes when I look at blog posts or talks or like people just doing stuff, I'm like, oh, this is wrong. This is not how a benchmark is supposed to be. And so the real question here is not, was that a good benchmark? It was like, how many benchmarking atrocities have we just committed? Like, how many really, really wrong and bad things have we done? And off the top of my head, or well, I prepared this, so it's not really the top of my head, I can think of a number of things that we did horribly wrong. So we took way too few samples. We took 3 for the enum each, and just 1 for the repeat n for the recursion one. And if you would have executed more often, maybe it would have been faster. Then also, is 100, is that realistic? Do you do 100 repeats? Or what the hell? There was no warm-up. So usually when we deploy an application, I think most of us here write web applications, right? Web applications? Yeah, most people. OK. So these are deployed to server and then run for days or something. And so it is important to us to know what is the performance after a couple of requests. We don't really care about the first minute because some environments are sort of slower in the first minute, but we care about the long-term performance. Also, IEX is not your production environment. There's so many things that can be so much different performance-wise in a shell. So I published a blog post and somebody was like trying to repeat it in the Erlang shell, and suddenly the performance characteristics were reversed because it behaves differently. So never do that. We have other questions like, does it really matter like when we create a list because we didn't include that into the measure time? Is repeating really the bottleneck? Because mostly it won't be. Because mostly whatever you do in a thing that you repeat a lot of times will be the real bottleneck, because enumerating is pretty fast, and it's pretty rare that you do something that is faster than enumerating within the enumeration. Also, the benchmark I showed you is not really repeatable. It's not checked into source control somewhere, so I can't recheck what it's doing. I've been missing setup information, like what version of Elixir was this run on, what was my computer, all that stuff is missing. And also, I was in a meeting, so I was probably running on battery power, and that is also not the production environment, and computers behave very differently when they're running on battery. And probably I also had my IDE running or something, so this was just terrible. So obviously this talk is about to tell you how to do it better, hopefully. And so this would be one way how to do it better. This is written with Benchee. So this is a repeatable benchmark where we first go, we actually check that maybe our repeat size is bigger. So we say, okay, we take 10,000 elements, we create the list before, we have the function, and then we just have a couple function that will benchmark. And Benchee will benchmark it for a couple of time and also run for a warm-up period. So by default, a 2-second warm-up period and a 5-second benchmarking time, take all of that and produce an output like this one, where you can see that, okay, actually the recursion version, the repeat n version, is much faster down here. I don't know if the people in the back can see that, but the enum each is actually 1.5 times slower at on average. And we also had a list comprehension version, which is even slower than this one. And we get other statistical errors that I won't get into detail about, but actually recursion is way faster, as we can see here, and our experiment from before led to a false belief. So please don't do that. Write proper benchmarks with proper benchmarking suits. So this is sort of the intro to this talk. It's called How Fast Is It Really? Benchmarking in Practice. I mean, lots of you were coming from Ruby, so I'll also talk about Ruby, so it's more of a general benchmarking talk as well. I'm Toby. You can find me on the internet as at PragTop. I'm a software engineer at Leafery, where we have a Elixir application, a little one, in practice all of Berlin, which does our career life tracking, which is pretty fun. And we are working on a bigger one right now. And yeah, I also run the Ruby User Group Berlin. I'm active in Red Squad, and I do lots of stuff. Also, if you've looked at the online online agenda, you've seen this photo of me. So in case you don't make the connection, this is me. And as a short look, this is where the picture comes from. And I don't know why they selected the picture. I found it was really neat. Like I sent them a variety of 4 different pictures, which was like a normal like profile picture that was taken by a professional photographer, me on stage, and I sent them this picture. And they choose this one, which is obviously the right choice. I don't know if they expected me to show up in the Fox onesie. It didn't work. I'm not that confident yet, but anyway, at this conference, I gave a talk in that onesie. It was just a lightning talk, but I did. Anyhow, moving on. This is just also a quick inserted, as Aaron had it in his talk this morning, that whole AlphaGo thing, deep learning, machine learning. I gave a talk about that at Full Stack Fest that year. It's called What Did AlphaGo Do to Beat the Strongest Human Player? So if you're into that kind of topic, this talk goes from zero, explains to you what Go is, what Monte Carlo research is, what a neural network is, what a deep neural network is, what a deep convolutional neural network is, and how that all plays together with that. And of course, benchmarking performance is very important. So if you're interested in that, look up that talk. So also about the style of this presentation, two of the styles are we're talking about the concept. So we're talking about the concept of benchmarking and how would that benefit us. And other talks are like, oh, here's this tool, here's how you use it. And I'll try to combine both. It will be a general benchmarking talk, as I said before. I'll also make some remarks about Ruby, as I reckon there's many Ruby folks in the crowd. But I'll also show it all at the example of a tool which is called Benchee, which I'm the principal author of, and which is a obviously a great benchmarking tool. And if you disagree or agree, please tell me, and I would love to chat about that. We already had the Ruby question, so thanks, Aaron, so I'm skipping that. One other distinction that we got to make in the beginning is the distinction of profiling versus benchmarking. And profiling is more like this. It gets you some sort of visual representation or some sort of representation of where do you spend your time in your code while executing. But usually when it does that, it adds a lot of overhead to your code because it needs to take a lot of measurements, so your code runs a lot slower. So the execution times that you see there are not really representative, but sort of how they relate to each other is representative. So profiling is good to take a look and see what do we actually want to benchmark, what is there to benchmark, and then afterwards use that information to benchmark. So we're going to talk about benchmarking, not about profiling. Also, when we're talking about benchmarking, it's important to know what do we actually want to measure. It's very common to measure just the runtime of functions, but we could also measure the memory consumption. For instance, in Ruby and Rails, if you fork a Rails application 8 times so it is parallel, then maybe memory consumption is a big problem for you because your server starts swapping. Another important thing is throughput for servers, so how many requests can my server handle? And oftentimes we have custom goals. And a great example from the Elixir world for custom goal is the famous blog post where we say the road to 2 million WebSocket connections in Phoenix. And there the goal was how many WebSocket connections at the same time can we have to one machine? And that is also a benchmark. And for instance, at Leafery, one of the other benchmarks that we have is we have routing algorithms. We have to have 500 packets and we create routes and say like which driver gets which packets and drop them off, and we have to do all of that in 15 minutes. And we have a quality metric for those routes, like how long does it take to go there? And that's another metric that we have when we have new algorithms. We sort of benchmark them against each other, which creates the best routes. So that's also a benchmark. For the purposes of this talk though, we're gonna focus on the runtime. Then the other question is why? Like why would we ever want a benchmark? What is there to gain? So first, the question is what's fastest? We had that with the recursion benchmark and the enum each benchmark. Then another possible goal might be, how long will this take? Like how long does it take to execute a certain thing? And this is a benchmark I ran for Benchee. It shows you, it is given a list of randomly sorted elements. So it's taken a list of 10,000, 100,000, or 1 million, or 5 million elements, which is then shuffled and then sees how much time enum.sort takes. So how much time does it take me to sort that? And you can see that even for 100,000 elements, it just takes 23 milliseconds. It's some calculation that I have to do during the statistics. So I want to see, is this doable? And even for the 5 million one, it takes about 2 seconds, which is not great, but still doable. And what might interest us here a lot, I don't know if you can read this, is maybe the maximum time that it took. Because sometimes when we're benchmarking, we're also interested in what's the worst case performance, or what's the worst case that can possibly happen, because we might be building real time systems and we can't allow a response time of over, I don't know, 20 milliseconds or whatever. I don't build these systems. So there's also possible use of benchmarking. And of course, the most popular use of benchmarking is, did we make it faster? So we implemented something, and we want to sort of have two solutions side by side and say, like, which one of those is faster? And now, at that point, in the back of the mind of some people, this might pop up. Like, isn't that the root of all evil? Like, optimization? I've heard something like that. That's bad, right? Why are you talking about this? Why are we doing this? So this is something for me which I would call a programming bumper sticker. It's like one of these sentences that people always say, like, optimization is the root of all evil, or premature optimization is the root of all evil. But they don't really know where it's coming from. They just repeat it so often that it's accepted as general knowledge and general truth. So for me, it's more like this. Not reading the actual sources of those quotes is the source of all evil. And if I might digress here a bit, if you know, or if you learned about the waterfall development model, you probably learned that Winston Royce invented it, which is not true. He has a paper where he doesn't call it waterfall, and you see the waterfall on the first page, or on the first two pages, and then he goes like, so this is something that I've seen, and now let me go and explain for the next 10 pages what is wrong with this model and how we can improve it. But someone took that paper and thought like, oh, the first page looks nice, I'm going to do this. And so all of a sudden, he was the inventor of that model. So let's see where that source of all evil stuff comes from. And it comes from Donald Knuth in a very popular paper. I think the name is Structured Programming with Go-To Statements, published in 1974. And what does he say? We should forget about small efficiencies. Say about 97% of the time, premature optimization is the root of all evil. So yes, he does say that. But if we read on just for the next sentence, yet we should not pass up our opportunities in that critical 3%. A good programmer will be wise to look carefully at the critical code, but only after that code has been identified. So he doesn't say, like, don't do it at all. Just be diligent about it and don't do it just all the time for the sake of it. Which is also something that is sort of embodied in the 80-20 rule. If you're not familiar with that, it says that 80% of your worth sort of comes from 20% of your time, or 80% of your impact, let's say, from 20% of what you're doing. And that is also very true for web applications. So oftentimes you have one very, very popular endpoint, and if you see like where the actual time of your web application is consumed, it's mostly 80% goes to one or two endpoints. So if you do improvements there, it helps. So if you use New Relic, you have a most time consumed view, which is great to find these sorts of things. And so application monitoring is really cool and great to find out what is critical, where are we actually spending time, where does it make sense to benchmark and improve our performance. And for our application, we have a sort of dashboard where you can see all ongoing shipments that are currently being delivered. And there it's true, 80% of our time is spent on those dashboards. Also, if we go back to that paper, in the prior paragraph, Donald Knuth says, in established engineering disciplines, remember this is 74, so we're looking at construction and stuff, a 12% improvement easily obtained is never considered marginal, and I believe the same viewpoint should prevail in software engineering. So he himself says that something sort of as low as 10%, as long as you don't do anything very, very complex, is very much worth the gain, and I agree. Of course. And he goes on later on in the paper, it is often a mistake to make a priori judgments about what parts of a program are really critical, since the universal experience of programmers who have been using measurements tools has been their intuitive guesses fail. And that's very true, which is why that application performance monitoring and profiling is very important, but we're not going to talk in detail about that. But I want to extend on that point and want to say that most programmers' intuition about what is actually fast and slow is also wrong. So let's try something. What's the fastest way to sort a list of numbers largest to smallest? And so sort of to do the descending sort. And we have a benchmark here, and I give you three options which you can choose from. The first one is we do an enum sort. We have a list, and then we have the custom sort function supplied where we just say sort it that way, like that the first argument is bigger than the second, which will result in that. The second one is we just sort a list and then we reverse it. And the third one, because we have a list of numbers, we just say, okay, don't sort by the value, but we're clever. We're saying sort by minus that value, which will also result in a descending sort. So I would like to have a show of hands who thinks the first variant is the fastest. One or two people, are we all playing? Okay, second variant is the fastest. That is roughly 40% or 50% of the room. And the third variant, that is 20 or 30%. You're pretty good. That is actually the fastest. Personally, I wouldn't have believed it. It's the same in Ruby, by the way. I personally would have sorted them the other way around. I would have thought that sort by minus value is the fastest than the custom sort function, because obviously that should be fastest, I thought. And then I thought then reversing the whole list should be the slowest, but it isn't. It's the fastest, also particularly because reversing the list is highly optimized in Elixir, as far as I know, or Erlang for that matter. And I mean, it's not even by a small margin. It's the sort of the custom function is 2.5 times slower than the reversing, and the other one is more than 4 times slower. So those are pretty surprising results, at least for me. But you did a great job. I'm proud of you. So let's continue talking about benchmarks. And we also have to talk about different types of benchmarks. And you probably know this. This is the testing pyramid. So we have unit tests, where we test individual methods. Then we have integration, where we maybe an object-oriented program would say, where we stick together multiple objects, or we have multiple things that are interacting with each other. And then we have feature tests, or end-to-end application-level tests that sort of exercise the whole application. We can liken this in benchmarking, and we can say, OK, we have micro benchmarks. Those are the ones that we've seen so far, mostly. Very, very small, narrow focus on one or two methods. Macro, where we do more stuff. And then application, it's basically sometimes even independent of the actual code, because it exercises the whole stack. So for instance, one example for an application level benchmark would be the Tech and Power benchmarks, where you just implement an application in different languages and frameworks. And then they benchmark it and then see who is fastest. And let's have a look at those. So another time for going through that. So for instance, the micro benchmark is like what we said. We benchmark sorting a list, descending order. What I often like to do as a macro benchmark is that I like to take one controller action, extract it, and then use run a benchmark against that one controller action only, which is very good to see what's going on and application, the whole thing, often independent. So when we go along there, oftentimes the components that are involved increase. With micro, it's a single method, and later on with the whole application, we have the whole web server, we have the traffic, like there's more and more components involved. Also, the setup complexity mostly goes up. If you think about that blog post with the road to 2 million WebSocket connections, they had to rent one server to run it on, then multiple servers to connect to and operate all of them. That's a very high setup cost, and the whole thing went on for days, if I remember correctly, or 1 or 2 days. With a micro or macro benchmark, you just have a bunch of code. Maybe you have to put data in a database, but it's not that hard to set up. Also, execution time often varies that it goes up, because a single benchmark for a single method executes fast, but then, of course, it gets more. But on the other hand, the more we go to the right side, the more that we are on the real application level, we have a confidence that the impact that we have is real. Because when I said that we benchmark repeating something n times, that will almost no time have like a real impact on the performance of our application, because whatever we repeat will likely be slower. When we benchmark against the controller action or the rendering of a whole page, we know that is actually what our users are doing. So it is much more noteworthy for us if we get a 10 or 20% performance improvement. Sorry. And also, we have sort of a chance of interference. Because when we do an application level benchmark, maybe our connection to the server is slow or that just broke down. There are many, many more components involved in it all. For instance, if we test browser rendering time, it could also be the browser that is at fault, for instance. Whereas in micro benchmarks, we really just have that one method. So whenever somebody shows you a shot like that, that goes from left to right, they probably want to tell you that there's a goal in the middle, and the thing in the middle is sort of the best and easiest thing, because it's a compromise of both sides. And to a point, I agree with this one, because macro benchmarks are, in my experience, easier to write while still giving you good enough results that are relevant to you and your application. And in this talk, we'll focus on micro and macro benchmarks. We're not talking about application level benchmarks. So the tools WRCAR2, WRCAR, Tsung, which they used for the sockets, we're not going to talk about those. And micro and macro benchmarks are also often in language, so written in the language itself, Elixir. Or Ruby, if you're looking for a good Ruby benchmarking tool, benchmark IPS is sort of the best thing. There. So let's talk about, let's talk more about what good benchmarking constitutes. So first, you really gonna know what are you benchmarking for? What is your final goal? Why are you doing this? What do you want to improve? Because sometimes we can benchmark stuff, but it doesn't matter. So for instance, at Elixir, we have a CSV export job that runs every day at, I think, 1 o'clock or something. And it's horrendous. Well, it's not horrendous, but you know, when I look at the log, I see so many database queries, I see so many N plus one queries, I just want to optimize it. But it doesn't matter in the end, because even if it runs for 2 hours, nobody's using the system at the time, so it doesn't really matter. Whereas endpoints that really matter to you, that are critical, is what you should be benchmarking. And at the same time, whatever you're going to benchmark for, and you have maybe that even part of your build or something, that is what people are going to optimize for. And sometimes they're going to do complex stuff and see that this is now the best thing, but they will lose focus of the rest of the application, which is bad. So really see what is your benchmarking goal. So also always provide a system specification. This is the specification of the system that I ran all these benchmarks on. So we have Elixir 1.3.4, Erlang 19.1, yada, yada, yada. You can see it, just so that you know. Next thing, we really want to have and we really need an interference-free environment, which means if you run the benchmark, make sure that your system is as idle as possible, except for the benchmark. No music listening, maybe even turn off Dropbox. Don't have your IDE running, because there's so many things that can just go and interfere with whatever you're doing. One of these things, for instance, is logging and other friends, which is one of the most common things when people write to the Phoenix talk mailers and say, like, oh, I run a benchmark, and it's really slow. It's like, oh, are you running in development mode? Yes, maybe try, you know, starting in production mode and turn down the logging, because the logging takes a lot of time, which is another very important factor. And also, this is sort of apparently controversial in Elixir and Erlang land. In Ruby, it is common, so benchmark IPS turns off garbage collection by default, last time I checked. But when I ask on the Elixir mailing list, like, how do I do this in Elixir or Erlang, people were like, no, don't do that for benchmarking. You're a bad person. Don't do that, which was kind of weird. So garbage collection just kicks in at some point and will increase the runtime, which I don't know how well you can see this, but this is a graph of all the runtimes in the order that they occurred of a specific benchmark. And you can see that there's lots of spikes. There's sort of a base level that goes on here, but there's lots of spikes coming out of it. And I can prove it right now because I have not implemented something to avoid garbage collection yet. I'm working on it, or well, I have an idea for it, but there's all these spikes, and those are most likely garbage collection. And when you're running a micro benchmark, you don't want to have that, because it just gets your average wrong with all of this. If you're running a macro benchmark or an application level benchmark, yes, then you want to have the garbage collection in there, because it's part of what's happening. But for a micro benchmark, it just skews the results in a very wrong direction most of the time. So when we zoom in a bit, we can see all these spiky things, which ideally we wouldn't want to have. Also, make sure that you have a correct and meaningful setup. Something that lots of people do very, very wrong is they don't have realistic data, like no data that resembles their production data. So they don't have 200 comments on an article. They just have 10, and then just, oh, this performance is fine. And then the article blows up, gets a lot of comments, and suddenly you notice that N plus one query or whatever is happening there, which is really bad. If you're working in other languages like Crystal, for instance, there's an optimize flag, or the production environment or the production compile, which makes things 5 times faster or something, and people just forget to do that, then benchmark against the wrong version and say, like, oh, this language is very slow, or your solution is very slow, while the compiler might have optimized it. And another thing I want to talk about is the so-called warm-up time. It's not that prevalent in Elixir and Erlang because they're not JITted languages, so they don't have a just-in-time compilation. But for instance, in languages on the JVM, just-in-time compilation sort of looks at your code and looks what's popular, what's run a lot, and then you try to optimize that and actually compile it down to machine code, which happens at runtime. Which means usually what you see there is that at first it's very, very slow, but then as time progresses, it jitters, which makes it slower. But then once it's jittered, it's lots and lots faster, which is one of the main issues I see with people sort of trying to benchmark JRuby, for instance, or Truffle and Graal. They just take the first iteration or the first free iteration and say like, oh, this is much, much slower than CRuby. Why is that? It's bad. And no, your benchmark is bad. You should give it ample warm-up time to sort of simulate that warm running server that I talked about before. And then you take those values that are generated then. Of course, also inputs matter. Like data in the real world is not synthetic. It's very, very, very shaped. So there's big data, there's small data, there's round data, there's lots of different things. For instance, about the shape of data, I think, if I'm not mistaken, the worst case performance for the standard implementation of quicksort is an already sorted list. That's the worst case performance. So if you have that as an input, suddenly it gets very bad. So always try to benchmark against a variety of inputs. And sometimes also the characteristics of algorithms change once the algorithm once the input gets bigger. Also, please don't mishandle your inputs. Don't give it an input that it's not supposed to get or treat the input wrongly. For instance, if you look at this, this is again the repeat benchmark, but right now I inlined the enum to list, like before was outside of the actual benchmarking code, which is the correct thing. Because what will happen here is that each time Benchee calls that function, it will always also run the enum to list of 10,000 elements, which takes quite a lot of time and takes much longer than the actual repeat function. So we'll get wrong results here because you included the creation of the list. This is something that happens quite easily, for instance, in Ruby, when you don't use the new frozen string literal or the frozen string magic comment, then whenever you write a string at that place, Ruby will create that string and it will always add to the time of your benchmark. And if it's just an argument to your function, normally that is not part of what the function actually does. So that's something you have to be very, very aware of. Another example, I actually wrote a blog post about that, is tail call optimization. And as some are rather new to function programming, tail call optimization is a specific optimization in function programming languages where you say in a recursive function call, if the last call in that function is a call to the method itself, it is optimized. It sort of gets optimized in a loop so that call doesn't actually occur and it saves memory and it's faster. So we have one version of the map function that is tail recursive and is therefore tail call optimized. And we have one that is body recursive because here it's not the last thing, because the last thing is actually the append or the prepend of the list. So if you want to benchmark that, this is again Benchee, and there's a new feature where you can give it multiple inputs. So I just created a variety of list sizes, 10,000 elements up to 5 million elements, and pass it to the input. So what it's going to do is it's going to run each of these benchmarking jobs that now get an argument, the list, and it's going to get the runtimes and measurements for all of those. And what we can see here, first, the real shocker for me at the time is for 10,000 and 100,000 elements, the body recursive function is actually faster. And I always thought tail recursive functions were always faster. It's not the case. I have a blog post about it that also explains about it. So if you're interested, look that up. What I'm interested in here now is that for 10,000 elements and for 100,000 elements, the tail recursive function is sort of at the bottom of the list. It's the slowest one, also slower than the standard library version that I put in as a reference. But once we get to 1 million or 5 million, suddenly the tail recursive function is faster than its body recursive and standard library siblings. And that is very interesting. And actually, first time I wrote this blog post, or when I wrote it, I didn't do this benchmarks, but somebody alerted me to it afterwards. So always use multiple inputs because what might well change. And then if you're benchmarking for yourself, use the input sizes that you really actually experience in your application, because only then is the benchmark really relevant to you. So another time with graphs, first standard library map was fastest, and then when we have 1 million elements, it's actually the slowest, but not by a large margin compared to body recursive, and tail recursive is the fastest. Now, let's go for a funny little excursion into statistics, because I've been showing you some graphs with funny whiskers and things like the median and stuff, but I haven't really explained, and I think it's important, and I hope you'll agree with me. So first, the thing that most people just take is the average. So the average, I decided to describe the concept in Elixir, because I think Elixir is the most commonly spoken language here, sort of. And the average is really easy. It's just the total time divided by the durations. And so why can't we just take the average for everything? Why am I saying that this is a bad metric or not the best metric? So therefore, I'm going to introduce to you to another concept, which is called the standard deviation, which is sort of, at first we compute the variance, which is we always add up the difference between the sample and the average, and that we square, then we divide it by the number of iterations, and then in the end we get the square root again. It's a standard statistical measure that sort of tells you the spread of values, because we're always subtracting the sample from the average. We see how far is that sample from the average, so how big is the spread, and because we square it, that effect is even bigger. And now let's look at the runtimes again, and we can clearly see here that we have all these spikes that go up, because maybe it's garbage collection, maybe it's something else. And something else that we can look at to see this spread of values is a histogram. And what a histogram basically does, it takes the runtimes and puts it into little buckets. I think here the bucket size is about 100, so all that are between 5,550 and 5,650 go into the same bucket. And here we can clearly see that, you know, the most common thing happens is way here. The fastest thing is the most common, but there's also a lot of other things happening. And especially those here are those little spikes, which we call outliers. There's something in the population or in the distribution that don't normally occur, but go there. And those have a really high impact on the average. So when we look at this, this is actually a sample of a very low standard deviation. If I remember correctly, it had about 8% standard deviation, which is not a lot. Well, I always give the standard deviation in percent, which is the actual standard deviation divided by the average, so that we have sort of a relative value that we can compare it to. So if you look, and the standard deviation is also denoted, if you wondered, in these bar charts that, in this little whiskers that shows like how big the standard deviation is, relatively speaking. And by the way, I did not say this before, these, if you read there, these do not graph the runtime, but they graph the iterations per second that you can do with this sort of runtime, which is a nice way to graph that, and which I stole from benchmark IPS, because then higher is actually better, you know? The biggest graph is the one I want to have, which is sort of intuitive, but if you graph runtimes, you know, actually the lowest bar is the one you want to have, so that's why I commonly show them as iterations per second. So now another statistical measure, the median, and this is where the sorting that I had to do before comes in, because to get the median in the easy way, not the complex way, we actually have to sort all the runtimes, and then we want to get the middle element. So when we sort all of them, we want to get like which one is the middle. And if we don't have a real middle, we sort of take the average of the two, but that's not too important. Why is that a good value? It's much more common to that this is a very common value that you will actually encounter in practice when you're doing this. It is very good at cutting off all these outliers, because when you sort them, even if you have all the outliers way over here, it won't influence which value is in the middle. And so it's also more stable. Across benchmarking runs, the average tends to go up and down a bit, but the median stays rather stable. So if we look at this distribution, this is sort of the bucket where the average lies of that distribution. But the median is way more over here, which is way more a common value. If you see the total occurrence of all those things, it's way more common to have that value. And again, another example, average would be here. The median would be here, which is more of a common value, what you would expect. And so I think it's a much better value to have. Of course, as I said before, the minimum and the maximum could also be very important for us, because we want to know the worst and best case performance, what can actually happen. Box plots, who has ever seen one of those? Who knows what they actually do? Don't worry, I was the same. I read a book, the comics book's guide to statistics, and that was actually explained. What they do overall is they sort of show you how values are distributed. So this little thing is the median of the values, and what you do to get these kind of graphs, you get the median, and the median then divides the population into two halves, the lower half and the bigger half. And then you also find the median of the lower half and of the bigger half, and that is here and there. So they show you like how many values are close around the median and how much do they spread out. This is runtimes now in microseconds. How do you get the whiskers? This quantile, it's called, minus that quantile, is the interquantile range. And then if you take that times 1.5 and see which values still lie within, you get these nice whiskers, and everything that is outside is graphed as a dot, which is then a suspected outlier. And you can see here our distributions, because of the spikiness, always go up, because those are all the outliers, maybe some interference or garbage collection or whatever. So let's get to a little, I mean, we're getting close to Christmas, to a little surprise bag of findings that surprised me. Maybe you will be good, like on the reverse sort example, and know what they do in advance. So flat map. This is one of the standard things I try to benchmark in new languages, because it was the first example I ever benchmarked with Benchee. It's the example in the README, because flat map is sort of map and flatten combined. It even doesn't do all of it. And so usually flat map is a lot faster than map.flatten. And again, I benchmark it against lots of values to see what does it do. And to my big surprise, in Elixir, map.flatten, that version is much, much faster than flat map. And it really boggled my mind. And in the beginning, I thought there must be a bug in Benchee, you know? So I tried all the other benchmarking tools, and they all reported the same. I was like, well, that is strange. But just so you know, in Elixir 1.3.4, map.flatten is much, much faster than flat map. Oh, and one other thing here. This is, again, the raw runtimes of the map.flatten run. And I don't know what happened here. Maybe, I don't know, Firefox. No, Firefox was not open, of course, because I'm good at doing benchmarks in an IIS system. But this one goes up to 2,500 microseconds, and the usual runtime is about 60 microseconds. So I don't know what happened there, but that is one of the biggest outliers I've ever seen. And also, all these little spikes occur fairly regularly, so I still suspect that this is garbage collection, but anyway. So another, for me, very interesting thing. This one sort of creates a map with 51 values and then merges in some other values that have six top-level keys that collide and then are very deep. I did this benchmark when I implemented a library or tried to implement deep merge for Elixir, or did. There's a deep merge package if you're interested. And it has a function that basically lets merge free. So merge free does the same as merge two, but you can adjust what happens when you have a key collision, and it just does the same thing that merge two would do. It just overwrites the value. And so I'm benchmarking this against the map. And now the question is, that is what merge free is doing now. And now the question I have for you is, what do you think? Like, obviously, I would think that merge free is slower somewhat than merge two, because it's a customizable version. But how do you think, how many times do you think it is slower? Do you think it, like, we have the options as fast as merge two, 2 times slower, 5 times slower, 10 times slower, 20 times slower? So who here thinks it's as fast as merge two? One person? Who thinks it's 2 times slower than merge two? A couple? 5 times slower than merge two? Yeah, another couple? 10 times slower than merge two? Another couple of people, 20 times slower than merge two, around 3 people. I don't think everyone played. Yeah, I know it's late. I try my best, really. I love benchmarking. I hope you love it after this talk too. Please don't hate it. So what's the result of this? It is almost 18 times slower than merge two. So the people in the end with the 20 times, I'll give it to you, you were right. Why is this? The normal merge 2 just goes to the Erlang maps merge, which is implemented itself in C and is super fast. And the merge 3 is custom implemented in Elixir and therefore is this much slower. And merge 2 is, of course, heavily optimized because it's something you do a lot. Which is, I mean, still it was very surprising to me. I would have also thought it was maybe 2 times slower. But yeah, today I learned, right? So, next thing. We have another implementation of map. Both are take call optimized, but there's a little difference. There's a little twist in them. And that is the function that actually does the tail call has a different argument order. So the first one gets first the accumulator, then the actual list, and then the function. And the second one, it's the actual list, then the function, then the accumulator. So the question is, does the argument order make any difference in this benchmark? Who thinks it does? Who thinks it does just because I bring it up and wouldn't have thought it otherwise? Yeah, obviously it does because otherwise I wouldn't make a big deal out of it. So it actually does make a difference. So when we look at just like this benchmark also still benchmark the standard library map function and the body recursive function, and we can see that every time, like for the two inputs that I got out there, the tail recursive with the argument order, which is the one with the switched argument order, is faster. And it's like, what? Like, why does that happen? And when we look at the graphs, it's OK, it's a little bit faster. I mean, the standard deviation is pretty high, so maybe it's wrong, but you can repeat it multiple times. It will always be faster. And then if we look at the box plots, you can also see that, yeah, it looks pretty much the same box plot, but just shifted down a bit, so it's faster. And then even if we compare the two histograms, this is the one with the new argument order, and this is the other one. And for me, it's almost scary how similar they look. But they're just, you know, they're just a bit shifted. So this one starts at around 20K and goes up to 300. And here, 25K is there. And so it's almost, it's a bit shifted to the right. And at this point, it cannot be, you know, the argument order cannot make a difference. It is just not possible. And I was like, this is somebody, something like somebody brought, came to my blog post and was like, hey, I get these different results. And I think it's because, I think he thought it was because he used a variable or something. I was like, oh, well, let me try. And I dissected it. And this was like the only difference between his implementation and mine that I could find was the argument order. And I couldn't explain it. So I was like, I was on my blog and was like, hey, I don't know why. Maybe if I meet Jose sometime, I'll ask him about it, I'll email him about it. Once I wrote that, a while Jose appeared an hour later, and I don't know how he did that. And he said, the order of arguments will likely matter when we generate the branching code. The order of arguments will especially matter if performing binary matching. And this is something I would have never suspected and never known, but thanks to someone else and thanks to benchmarking, I don't know that it might make a difference, and even a pretty big difference sometimes, if we, sorry, go back for a bit. Yeah. Here, the difference is quite huge. I mean it's 10%, but it is almost 10%, so that's quite something. OK. So sort of start to wrapping up. Because this is an Elixir conference and lots of you are new, I implemented a benchmarking library before in Ruby. And I just want to say how lovely Elixir is and how Elixir guided my design of Benchee. Because this is now how I think about benchmarking. I think it's a beautiful concept, and it also plays into that one data structure that you just pass around. We start off with a configuration, then we do the init, which sort of merges the provided configuration with the default configuration. Then we gather information about the system, right now the Elixir and the Erlang version. Then we define which benchmarking jobs will be run. Then we actually run them. Then from those results, which are raw runtimes, we compute the statistics. And then those statistics and all the other stuff is just supplied to different formatters, which prints the console formatter or the HTML formatter, which looks pretty nice. And then it does that thing. And there's something that it's so easy to do new formatters for it, which wasn't the case in my Ruby library. And it's really the design, or well, the function programming, or that thought. That function program is a lot about a transformation of inputs until I have the final output that I want, which guided this design. And it's really beautiful. So this is basically, or this is what Benchee.run does under the covers, but you can also, so this is actual code. So you can actually also use this interface to Benchee. It's official, but it's not as terse as Benchee.run. So yeah, last week I implemented the HTML formatter, which is super nice and gives you all those graphs that you've seen here, and you can export it as PNG. So I want to encourage you to always do your own benchmarks. And to really, really encourage you to do that, let's remember that flat map benchmark, and let's just change one little thing, one little detail, which is my Elixir version, which is 1.4.0 release candidate 0, and then run the same benchmark. Run the same benchmark. Yes, we're running it. We're getting information. La 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 la. And yes, it is exactly. It is Elixir 1.4, and now the tables have turned, and suddenly. Well, suddenly FlatMap is faster, and it's over 2 times faster than the old version of FlatMap. And this is just so you know that things can change in your environment. And by the way, how did this happen? So this is real. It's really faster now. So forget what I said before, basically, unless you're still running Elixir 1.3.4. How did that happen? Well, actually, it was the first benchmark I wrote, and I always thought it was weird. So I actually wanted to fix it myself, but I looked at the implementation, was like, OK, maybe not, maybe next week, and after 8 weeks or something, I was like, okay, let's open an issue in Elixir. Like, let's say this is, I don't know, this should be faster, but it isn't. Why? And then, and this is true, within 18 minutes, Jose showed up, apparently read that whole thing, and said like, okay, here I've written you 2 implementations, like 2 new FlatMap implementations here for you. Could you maybe just benchmark them? In 18 minutes, came up with those, and they work. I tested them. And indeed, all those 2 implementations, both were faster than the current FlatMap implementation, and one of them was actually faster than Erlang's FlatMap implementation, and like much, much, like it's the new implementation that you see here. It was over 2 times faster, and he did it in 18 minutes, which is, to me, still one of the most fascinating things I've ever seen in programming, and one of the nicest things. And then in the end, Jose thanked you for, thank you for benchmarking. So this is what I want to finish with. Please enjoy benchmarking and have a lot of fun with it. Thanks.